Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Remain in my love. Love one another as I have loved you. My dear people of Achonry-Mullinabreena, you're all invited to listen, though. But I would like to address the people of this parish first. It's good to be with you today, gathered in this beautifully renewed church of the Sacred Heart. The Sacred Heart of the love of Jesus. I'm deeply conscious of how you have prepared for this day. The effort and time put in, especially over the past year almost. The choir began practicing at Halloween. And all so that this would be what it should be, a day to remember. A day when you are at your best as God's people, as a family of faith. Thank you. And thank you for Paul. I'm deeply conscious too that this is the parish of St. Nathan, the parish that gives its name to the diocese. St. Nathan is our patron and our father in faith. Being here focuses us on the origins, the beginnings of the faith story of this diocese, all of 1500 years ago. And how deep are the roots of the faith that is expressed so eloquently in all the preparations, as in all that we are doing today in ordaining Paul Kivlehan as priest. In this year of faith, it is no accident that we are having our first ordination to the priesthood in 10 years. And that the ordination is taking place here of all parishes, in the parish of the priest Nathan himself, with whom the faith story of our diocese began all those centuries ago. The faith womb from which Paul the priest is being born today is very deep. People of Achonry-Mullinabreena, you have restored and renewed this church building for this day on which you give Paul to the diocese as priest. Please let us all pray today and let deep reflection begin now on the treasure that is our Christian faith, and what it means to belong to Jesus, and with Jesus, to God's family. And how can that gift of faith be renewed and restored in the hearts of all people of this diocese of St. Nathan? Wouldn't it be wonderful if this day could mark a new beginning for faith in our hearts and in the hearts of all in our diocese? I am full of hope. In that context of renewal, I am reminded of what Pope John Paul II said at Knock in September 1979, Paul, the very month in which you were born. The task of renewal in Christ, he said, is never finished. Every generation with its own mentality and characteristics. And it's too true, don't we have our own mentality and characteristics? Is like a new continent to be won for Christ. The church, not just the priests or the bishops, must constantly look for new ways that will enable her to understand more profoundly and to carry out with renewed vigour the mission received from our founder. Now, if all that was true just after you were born, Paul, in 1979, it is even more true today. And we take these words to heart on this day of profound hope. And yes, why not? This day of new beginning for all of us. I want to welcome your family, Paul. I've done so already. But I'd like to do so again. There are many of them here, including your brother Walter, and innumerable other relatives. But I want especially to welcome again your parents, Annie Mae and Walter. They have been your first teachers in the ways of faith, your best teachers. And you will find, Paul, no matter how many professors you meet, that they will continue to be your best teachers. A home and parents where prayer and faith is part of the air we breathe is a fountain from which you will continue to draw ever deeper strength as you respond to God's call and seek to bring the good news of God's love to others in your priestly ministry. And that especially when the going gets tough. And it will be times. In a few moments, we will continue with the ordination ceremony. It is a solemn and joyful ceremony, with many moments rich in word and in sign. The final moment will be when your parents will bring forward the chalice and paten, which I will present to you with the words, "Accept from the holy people of God the gifts to be offered to him. Know what you are doing and imitate the mystery you celebrate. Model your life on the mystery of the Lord's cross. This entire ordination ceremony is embedded in the Holy Eucharist, which is the mystery of the Lord's cross. Out of that mystery, though, resurrection and new life are born. And out of this mystery, too, your priesthood is born. Today, you become a man of the Eucharist. A priest doesn't just preside at the Holy Eucharist. He becomes Eucharist, taken, blessed, broken, and given. Know what you are doing, the ceremony will state in a moment, and imitate the mystery you celebrate. Already, in responding to that small, persistent voice, which you recognized in several seemingly small but key moments in your life, you are very much aware of the fact that responding to God's call to priesthood costs. There is a cross. The preface of today's Mass, speaking of the priestly vocation, puts it well as it prays to God for priests. It says, as they give up their lives for you, give up. And for the salvation of their brothers and sisters, they strive to be conformed to the image of Christ himself and offer you a constant witness of faith and love. The commitment to celibacy made with diaconate, the promise of obedience today, are part of that giving up, that witness of faith and love. Priesthood doesn't come cheap. Were this not a Sunday, we would be celebrating on this day, June the 9th, the feast of the great Saint Cullen Kill, one of the secondary patrons of our country. Talking of Cullen Kill, there's an ancient little tale recounted in the Book of Lismore. It tells us that Cullen Kill came to visit Nathan here in Achonry one time. Along with him were two other famous saints and founders of churches, Saint Cainnach of Ossory, Kilkenny, and Saint Cumgal of Bangor, the famous monastery that sent Columbanus all over Europe. They arrived after the evening meal, and Nathy left them without food till the morning. It was normal, it seems, in ancient Irish monasteries for people to fast at that time, after the evening meal. Mm-hmm. And then the Book of Lismore goes on to tell us that in the morning, when he met them, Nathy assessed their reactions. Fasting was very much a central part of Christian practice in ancient Achonry. The fact is worth pondering, but you can't suspend the pondering till after tomorrow. You see, Nathan, the good priest that he was right. Assessing the reaction of his friends to the fasting. In other words, to the sacrifice, the situation they found themselves in, demanded. How often do the situations we find ourselves in become demanding? Life as priest in that sense invites us to fast often, as indeed it invites all the people of God whose servants we are. And that's how it was too for the Master who has called us. Fasting even to the ultimate deprivation and desolation that was Golgotha. But that's not all, Paul. Already you have tasted too the truth of resurrection, of new life and joy. You've come here today surrounded by love, family, friends, neighbours, community, fellow priests. The rock-like security of knowing you belong and are cherished. This ceremony and this day with all its preparations, as already mentioned, is redolent of sacrifice and unselfish giving. And all of that a sure image and taste of the infinite love of the one Jesus reveals to us all as Father. We beautify our churches so they will remind us of heaven and the great joy that is the fulfillment of all human longing. We are a people of resurrection in the final analysis. And that's what you are ordained to be today. But feet firmly planted in the whole of the Paschal mystery, because you're a man of the Holy Eucharist. The Mayflower is in full bloom outside, and the sun is glorious in the sky for a whole novena of days now. Our ceremony here is rich, and we are all gathered in faith and hope and love around you. God is doing a good thing in you, Paul, for all our sakes. Thank you for your yes to him. And may he who has begun this work in you bring it to fulfillment. In Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Amen.